Hey y'all, this is Synopsis, and this is the Synopsis show for the 14th of February 2022. So today we're going to talk about High Warriors, and if you were to drink in some coffee, just have a little bit left. The start on the other side of me. Dark Knight, but Mug still using it, you know, still. Absolutely fantastic mug. So I got some amiibos there in the corner on the bed over here. So yeah, you can use 5 amiibos per day in High Warriors. Only have one more character now to unlock. I actually made a mistake that I thought unlocking Yuga would be hard, but I completely forgot on the Link Between Worlds map. This is not explained 100% properly. Like, there's a portrait frame or thing that you can use, which is the Link when he, you know, goes between the worlds, you know, goes from Hyrule to Lowrule and stuff like that. So on the Adventure Mode map, on the Lowrule map, which is the final map, there's a light world to the left side and the dark world, Lowrule, to the right side. It looks like the dark world, of course, in Kanda, like the dark world in A Link to the Past, but it's not the same place, because the Dark World is of course the golden land after Ganondorf made his wish, you know, when he was, you know, a thief or whatever, you know, when he managed to get hold of the Triforce somehow, and that turned it into the Dark World, the golden land. So yeah, and the thing was for example, like, if you use it on a fissure, then you just change the element of it and stuff like that. But if you complete the map square and then you use the paint thing, or the what looks like the 2D Link, the 8-bit Link, the Zelda 1 Link, and then it's the, you know, when you're going through, you know, what you're doing, A Link Between Worlds. If I remember correctly, in A Link Between Worlds, the case, I mean, I should have the keys over here. Megatron has to go out. Megatron has to go out of his place. This was actually the first lead class Transformers. Like, Transformers are much harder to get here in Sweden, depending on where you are. That's of course the, you know, the thing I got a long time ago, many, many years ago. I think we got it on the first or second year that we lived in this house, but yeah. Man, so many 3DS games. Oh yeah, I played Mario Sticky Star, some Mario 3D Land, The Legend of Zelda: Ocarina of Time, Smash Bros. For the Nintendo 3DS, Resident Evil Revelations, The Legend of Zelda: Mario Smash 3D, A Link Between Worlds, New Super Mario Bros., Luigi's Mansion 2, Resident Evil Mercenaries 3D, and Fire Emblem Awakening. Alright, and Rayman 3D over there. Okay. What the hell? I thought I had. Curious. Of course, I do have some digital games also on the 3DS. I keep forgetting that, because I do have a big memory card for it, so you know. Well, maybe you could not do it. Well, I did. Right. So look at this here. Look at this here. This is the artwork. See the artwork? Basically the light world place with the Master Sword. Looks like that on the back. The cart. Yeah. And then, for example, if you look in here, you can clearly see Zelda artwork. Let me pull this out here. Let me pull it out completely. This is the default cover art. This is the one that normally shows on this A Link Between Worlds. But this one, I think, is more similar to the picture in the A Link to the Past artwork book. This is basically kind of like they have redone a certain artbook that's in the original, like A Link to the Past thing. Oh, I need to remember how to line this up here, because this is not easy to line up and get it like proper to like make it like not and not go bad. It's very, very... Or that's too... Like, it's very, very easy to get it because of the fact that how long this is, that you have to make sure that it doesn't, like, go like, you know, like... It has to kind of go straight, but it doesn't. It keeps going going not straight in one of the areas, and you know, like... I think that's gonna be the best I can do. There we go. Because I prefer that background, of course, which is the one that I am using. But the golden one is normally what the background is on A Link Between Worlds. But yeah, you know. Should I use all my 3DS games? I don't know. I mean, I might as well do. Might as well do it because we have a chance. And I need to move my Lord of the... Oh no, this is the Legend of Zelda, the CD thing for the Legend of Zelda toilet. Toilet Princess. Some of the 3DS games. And these are just the physical ones, these are not the digital ones. Although, I think I only have like one or two digital games. So, we just move the Put a Link Between Worlds. There we go. Put a Link Between Worlds there. So I don't think I have ever shown all the 3DS games I have before. So let's go about VR release, kinda. Ocarina of Time was one of the release games. So was Mercenaries 3D. Wait, what? Yeah, Resident Evil. Oh, right. Further back here. Alright, I did that because it became uneven. That's why I did that. So I'm gonna move the Mario Maker thing there. Oh. Okay, so right, this is just Amiibo packaging for the Mario 30th anniversary. I should have kept the packaging for the other one, but yeah, this is also one of the release games. This is the, of course, the Rayman 3D. Here we have Mercenaries 3D, Resident Evil Mercenaries 3D. Yeah, the artwork on some road back isn't really that good. The Rayman one is pretty good though, which is actually a remake of a certain I think it's a PlayStation 2 Rayman game, if I'm not mistaken. It's, of course, Ocarina of Time. It doesn't have two different fonts, though. It just has the boring, you know, like... Right. Look how, like, bad certain backs are, like, compared to this. Like, oh, this pops out. It's colorful. And I can understand they have to have, like, this big area here, but still, like, they could have that text being like different or something like that, and make it be digital, just make it like a scan code so you could have like full artwork on the back. Then of course, I don't remember all of the release times on the other games. So here we have New Super Mario Bros. 2, which is of course a sequel kind of to the Wii game. Or regular one on the DS, the New Super Mario Bros. I like this golden thing though, with whole coin focus, and then it's actually like like this. In that, I haven't checked what the full thing looks like. Okay, there is a bunch of that, so you could have this as the front, but that would look weird as a front, to be honest. Oops. Yeah. I should have just deactivated the skin saver. Then we have Luigi's Mansion 2. Artwork on the back. That's a bit better actually with the artwork on the back. Fire Emblem Awakening. Sick artwork on the front. Okay-ish on the back. Can I get an idea? Mercenaries 3D. This is actually really cool because it's basically like one of those things on a boat, like one of those windows. Or like on a sub almost. And then you have Yill. Yill in all her horny glory. Yeah, she's super horny in Revelations. Because she literally flirts with the guy. And she's like, okay, like let's make her ass even tighter this time around. And then you have Super Smash Bros. 3DS. Whoa. This has a sick background, by the way. This, look at this. Look at this back. So many fighters. And it is pretty, pretty crazy. All the stuff that was in the 3DS version of it. Then we have Paper Mario, Sticky Storm. Look at that. So happy. And the background is kind of nice there. Because here's the thing, right? Certain ones are very, very anomalous here in the back. Here they are like boom colors. Boom colors. Right, because they also are using like colors that work well together and stuff that, so yeah. Super Mario 3D Land, which by the way is like underrated. Like Super Mario 3D World is of course more like open. This is more like Mario 3 kinda-esque. And then you have in here even, you have like stuff like that in there, so yeah. And then of course a little bit of artwork there also stands out a bit. And then of course my favorite, Majora's Mask. Because I never had IN64, you know, and stuff that I'm used to, you know. The artwork again is a bit bad, like it's very, very, very tiny screens, and then it's like yeah, what are you doing? And then it's not even in there, because it is in my 3DS current. There you have the XL, the 3DS, and the 2DS. I have both the original model of the 3DS. I have the 3DS XL, and I have the thing. So that's Super Mario. But let's put all the Super Mario things together. And let's put all the Zelda things together. Ocarina of Time, there we go. New Super Mario Brothers. I will count Luigi's Mansion also in the video from that. And so, there we go. Okay. Hold, please. Beep, boop, boop. Hold, please. I mean, I could show you also my... Ah! The volume sliders. Who the fuck is Leon? Help! Leon! What are you doing, Leon? Quick smash. Oops. God damn it. Who the fuck? What do you mean, Capcom? Where did Medusa? Okay. I should move these. You see how much I can do. Maybe I should just make a bottom section. The games, I don't know. So those first, then all the Mario stuff. Yeah, in reverse order, then kind of. Instead of. Two Resident Evil games next. Yeah. Like that, boom. The one that you got with HD, with one of the special versions of it. stuff that they also more the other tracks. And you also got the Let's Go Fuck Some Dude. I mean, that's not what they're singing, you know, but it kind of fits, you know. And I don't know why I thought about that, you know, the first time I heard the song, but Let's go fuck, let's go fuck, and then if you think about the people who owns that shop in the game, that is like very, very disturbing. Hey, welcome, by the way, now you cannot unhear it. Maybe I should move my Switch games up there. They could actually fit. No, they cannot. Ah, there is a little bit too long. So these are the physical Switch games, of course. Just a bit quick there, you know. I mean, I've showed them before, you know, but, you know, in case, you know, someone hadn't seen them before. Yeah, at some point I had to go over all the Wii U games. Like, there's so many of them. There's like... I'm not gonna count Super Mario 3D Make it twice, because I think I have it also... 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6... Well, 13, 14. Oh, but the Mario Maker is not here. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. So 15 physical Wii U games. pretty crazy. Now I do got a lot of storage space up here, actually, if I could actually move these games. I can move my PS4 games up there as well. And stuff that, like, I'm trying to figure out, like, room and stuff there, because if I could free up enough room, then I could have my... Although I don't know how high the Warhammer books are. Well, maybe that's why I'm gonna do stuff. I wonder if the microphone can even pick this up here. Where is the Allspark? Yeah. And he glows in his eye, and his mouth actually moves. That's all, which is nice, you know. A very nice glow it was. Trying to get him in again. Now you behave. And don't. Oh no, his feet. Oh, god damn it. Capcom! No, what the fuck are you doing, Capcom? No, Capcom, now. Yeah, good lad, and put your fusion cannon closer. Because that's the, probably one of my favorite Megatons, the animated one. Because the animated series was incredible when it came out. Although I also like really like Red. Not the Robots in Disguise, not the like newer one, but the older one. And stuff that, you know. Because, you know, that one was actually Japanese from the start and not, like, American and stuff that. And that you can kind of tell with the whole the voice acting thing, and it's kind of more anime-esque, you know. And stuff that. But anyway, so, Hyrule Warriors. So, here's the thing, right? So, there's a limit of 5 amiibos per day. Now, the amiibos will only unlock up to... Like the weapon amiibos, like all of the Zelda one, unlock different weapons for different characters. And then if you use a Misk amiibo, like from something else, then it can give you random stuff. Like you could get extremely lucky with a rupee drop, like sometimes it can give you one rupee, but I believe, I forgot what the maximum is, because I think you can like get really lucky and get like a million rupees eventually and stuff that. But yeah, another thing though, that I find this stupid, like, I don't know if people have stats over the amiibos or if it's just completely random, but certain amiibos tend to have a better chance to give you certain good stuff. Like, I mean, the 8-bit Link amiibo, for example, that one is more expensive or more worth, you know, and stuff like that. But it depends on how many they do. It's the 8-bit Link. Now, the sad thing is that they haven't released multiplier of these, I don't think. Because, okay, so it has, first off, it has the magical shield. It doesn't have the default shield, which is much, much smaller. It also has the white sword. It does not have the wooden sword, which I'm guessing because you can get the white sword just extremely quickly. You don't need to even enter a dungeon before you can get, like, the white sword. Same thing with technically, you can get the blue ring before you do the very first dungeon, if you know what you're doing, you know. And stuff like that. So Link goes around. No, it would be more from this side if he is going that direction. Stop playing with toys! You don't tell me what to do, motherfucker! Or, you know, like when you're going down the case, like, like they have to fake you going down. I mean, they kind of look like the character is going down when you go down a cave instead of one. Instead of one, by the way. Good hype, you know. I really, really like it, how it's like very, very 3D-esque and stuff that, you know. And stuff that, you know. It would be appreciated if it's... If, I mean, it's the Zelda anniversary this year, I believe it is. So why can I hope they make a blue ring version of this. That's like the blue mail and then maybe the wooden sword instead. Because, you know, you decided to go to skip the thing because you're speedrunning, but you're maybe not super good at speedrunning. So you get the blue ring instead of just the green tunic and stuff that. And then, of course, there should be a red ring one with also the magical sword and stuff that, you know. Yeah, because it's the rings that gives new tunics or whatever logic there is. You know. And of course, I have the Ganondorf there from Smash. I have the Samus from Samus Returns, I believe it is. And I have the Zelda one as well. So yeah, let's put this in the corner here and stuff. Man, that frees up so much room, really. It's ridiculous how much it needs to freeze up. Yeah. Oh, it's ridiculous how much room it frees up. But yeah, but the thing is, I should have finished my thought. So then maybe it was just 5 you can unlock each day, and it resets at midnight each day. Yeah, there's a bag I got over there, by the way. Over here. I haven't opened it yet. I thought about opening it before, but yeah. Those, by the way, are the Serbian snacks, because it says like this here on the back. It says like... Proizvodi, produced by... and stuff that tillverkade av... Beograd Republika Serbia. And it's RS. You know, Beograd. But maybe Serbia is actually like, not like Serbia, but it's instead like Russia, but it's like a place in Russia called Serbia. Because it got Ares, and Ares is Russia, I believe. So yeah. Maybe it's, but this is one of the things I got on my birthday that I got some twice. Yeah, fresh baked peanuts, taste like peanut butter. Really good. Lots of protein also in it. It's the protein amount. It's 13 grams protein in 100 grams of this. And this bag is 150 grams. So that's decent. And then there's quite a lot of fat. Uh, 39 grams of fat. And the other thing is... And the other thing is the... Only 1.8 grams of sugar also, so it's not very sugary. But this basically tastes like peanut butter, this. I think they are really, 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 really good, by the way. Really, really excellent snack. Also, actually works really well with beer as well, so, you know. Amazing. Amazing. But yeah, so, yeah, and I don't know why, because, like, the thing is, the Link came out before the anniversary, because there was a year on the 25th anniversary, I think it was, because it's the 30th now, I believe it is. So on the previous anniversary, there was, that's when they released the 8-bit Link, but I believe also at the same time or later on, they released the Ocarina of Time Link, they released Majora's Mask Link, they released a Twilight Princess Link, although technically the Smash Link also counts as the Twilight Princess Link, because that's the model that was in Smash at that time, you know, and not the Breath of the Wild Link. And then of course I have the Breath of the Wild Link, the one with the bow, and I have the Breath of the Wild Zelda. I do have, of course, the Wolf Link, which is with the box. I have it somewhere, the box for the blah, blah, blah. Is it still here somewhere? Maybe I put it in here. No, I did not. So it's probably, it's probably here, down here somewhere below all the other boxes. So yeah. Yeah, because it was with the, you know, with the, you know, the HD version of Twilight Princess, which I never got to finish really, because, you know, once I got the Switch, I couldn't have the Wii U plugged in anymore. So yeah, it's a bit bad, you know, and I really, really hope that all of the stuff that had been leaked, you know, is true, you know. Of course, if that's the case, there's gonna be like a disc with both, like, or like a game that's probably gonna have both Twilight Princess on it HD and Wind Waker HD. And I mean, I don't mind buying both of those again, you know, and stuff that, you know. Of course, there's also like the Majora's Mask one as well as a figure. Because the thing is, like, for example, once you use the 30th anniversary or that 25th anniversary link, then you cannot use the other ones. You cannot use the other ones at all. And that is like really, really weird. Like, once you use this link, you cannot use another one. And then that seems weird, right? And it might have been that I didn't have many characters unlocked at that point, because I definitely think that either Majora's Mask Link or specifically the Ocarina of Time Link, although the Ocarina of Time Link is actually the adult version, but the Majora's Mask Link should count as actually giving weapons to young Link. I don't know if all those things are coded into the amiibo from the start, or if it can get added via patches and stuff like that, but they should definitely like patch in what weapons you can gain from certain of the characters and stuff like that, and maybe have specific weapons from certain specific ones, you know. But yeah, the 8-bit Link should be giving 8-bit weapons, by the way, even if you quote-unquote don't have them unlocked and stuff like that, you know. Which I believe actually in the original Wii U game, you could get the strong weapons earlier, or maybe you could not, but yeah. But once you have like once you have unlocked most of the weapons, including the there's, you know, the magical sword, for example, for Link, but then there's a magical sword plus, but there is also another tier weapon, like the final tier of weapons are like double element weapons. So then you cover two different elements, and the damage is kind of much the same, but yeah, and then they're called something else. So the magical sword becomes something like blah 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 magical sword, or whatever, you know. I think I even looked it up at one point, just what they were called, because, you know, like, even if I look up something, like, I don't remember it and stuff that, you know. So yeah, where do we have it? No, that's not the one. I'm trying to remember here. I know what I looked up at one point, just the weapons, you know, just to see what their names was, you know, and stuff like that. So, No, that's just how to unlock the weapons. Which, by the way, I can never remember all of the, like, the square names and stuff that, you know, because, you know, it's, like... But I do remember at one point finding, like, a list that was with all, like, the... That's just amiibos there. Zelda amiibo with playable characters in game. Link, Zelda, Sheik, Ganondorf, Wolf Link. So yeah, so basically any Link counts, any Zelda counts, Sheik count as well. So yeah, so you can use the Smash Link if you want to, like, you know. What each Legend of Zelda amiibo can gift you regardless of the series, Super Smash Bros, the Legend of Zelda, the Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, you know. One important thing to note is that any weapon that you receive will be limited to the only weapon ranks you currently have. And then if you only have a 3-star weapon, so you will only receive 3-star weapons from your gifts at the highest level, so yeah. And I believe you can also receive higher than 3+ now, because of the fact that they've added more stuff. Zelda amiibo without playable characters in game, the following amiibo generally gives the same support as an item. Bokoblin, Guardian, Daruk, Mipha, Ravala, Ravali, Urbosa. So if you have those ones, you can receive rupees, materials, and weapons. All non-Zelda amiibo gifts rupees, materials, and weapons at random. There's no knowing what you will get. Technically, they can actually be better to use the random ones instead of the specific Zelda ones. Because having the chance to get rupees, like... You can use hit jackpot with that, you know, and stuff that. I don't know if they have a list anywhere with like the amiibo rewards and stuff that, but yeah. Ugh. But I still haven't found that list. Like, they did not get saved then when I looked that up. And stuff that, because I do remember at one point looking up like the... Because I mean, it should say like weapons, right? Okay. Okay, there's outfits, there's costumes. And there's so much costumes in this. It's ridiculous. All right. Hidden character, hidden level 1, and weapon locations. Alright, because it's a level 1 version of the other ones. And they're generally mostly on Adventure Mode Map 1. Except for certain of the DLC characters, or certain other characters like Ravio is on Lord Rule, of course, obviously. Medley is on Great Sea, of course. Marin is on Koholint, because Koholint is the island in that cave. And then level 3 weapon locations, which is of course like Fies through Goddess's Blade, where Link has the medical sword. And then level 4 weapon locations, and Link then is medical sword plus. And level 4 weapons are basically the best, except that there is level 4 plus weapons, and those are like the special version that has like 2 elements to them. These are similar to normal level 4 weapons, but contain additional elements and stuff that, and you know, you need to clear with A ranks again. And then so Link's medical sword becomes Dark Magic Sword. So it's light and dark, which is a pretty good combination. You can definitely hear with the name like Liquid Goddess's Blade, so that's like a water holy, water light, holy, I'm gonna call it holy instead. And I'm gonna call Dark Unholy. Or no, just call it Dark. What else stand out here? Link will get Luminous Crossbow. Wait, so her crossbow is not light from the beginning. It's a different element then. Yeah, probably. I'm trying to see what stands out here. yeah, Lokom or Sword of Oceans. Lokom is pretty interesting because that's not the name of the Master Sword for Tony. I'm guessing that might be a Spirit Tracks weapon or what is it called, the other one? Spirit Tracks and I had Spirit Tracks, or I have Spirit Tracks still somewhere. But the other one is the Phantom Hourglass. Yeah, Phantom Hourglass. What else? The Tomb Cell gets Flaming Wrecker Sword, so that's Flame plus whatever her default element is, which I believe is Holy. Inflame the Deity's Mask. Young Link, I believe his element is... is it Dark? I forgot what the default element is. Or certain other ones, but yeah. Ganondorf is pretty interesting here. Something called Swords of Renewal. Which that actually sounds completely unique. Because his level 4 plus weapon is Swords of Demise plus. So Swords of Renewal doesn't sound like Dark, it just sounds like it switches elements. So that would be Dark Light, I'm guessing. Swords of Renewal. Could it be Water otherwise? Because there's Dark, there's Light, Holy. So Unholy, Holy. There's Water, there's Fire, and there's Lightning. Those are the elements. Yeah, there's no like earth element and stuff that, you know. There's no like life elements. A Sword of Renewal is interesting. And of course, also one thing to keep in mind is that you have... here's the Master Sword unlocks, but I already know about these ones. Because I did it back on the Wii U. And keep in mind, when I did it back on the Wii U, I did it before the later DLC had come out. So I did it at the hardest possible points when all you had access to was a Master Quest map, and it was on the Master Quest map where you could unlock the level 3 weapon. So Evil Spain, acquire every weapon in the game level 3 and below, so you need to get all of those weapons, then kill 10,000 enemies using Master Sword to unlock Evil Spain, and that powers up the sword. And then Exorcism, acquire every weapon in the game including level 4 and level 4 plus weapons, then kill 15,000 enemies. And then unlock both Evil Spain and Exorcism for the Master Sword. Then kill 10,000 enemies. But I mean, it is not possible to have Exorcism right before you get Evil Spain. But it's kind of better to not start farming the kills like right away and instead just focus on getting all the unlocks for it first. And stuff like that, you know. But yeah. That is interesting, but yeah. So all of them are level 4 weapon locations are different here. So some are in the Termina map, because that's the plus location. So the level 3 ones are all Master Quest map, except for certain of the other ones, like Koholint Island for Link also. Is it meant to be connected to Link's Awakening somehow? That is interesting, that's just connected to the Koholint map. Is there any character in Link's Awakening that could be Linkle? It's a question, because Linkle is kind of like a favorite for like the team that makes Zelda now. The what is it called? Eiji Amora or whatever it is. Probably butchering the name, but still, you know. So okay, so Linkle is Koholint Island, Marin is of course Koholint Island as well. Oh yeah, but the level 3 crossbow is on Master Quest map, okay. Because of course they have things down the walls, and keep in mind of course that there are certain people that when they play this version again, they think that, oh, I've gotten so much better at the game, this used to be hard to do on the Wii U, but now it's so easy, and that's because they have actually rebalanced difficulty, so Twilight Princess is not ridiculous hard as a map anymore and stuff like that, because yeah. So yeah, that is very interesting. And of course, level 4 weapon locations, we saw the plus version of weapons. So Agita is, of course, Twilight map, CIA's terminal map, Darunis terminal map, terminal map. And then there's a bunch in the Twilight map as well. Twilight terminal. And then, of course, Corlint Island for Lickle and Marion. Medley is Master Wind Waker map. And then there's Toon Link. And Toon's Hello, of course, is Grand Travels map, which is the harder version of the Wind Waker map. And, of course, Yuga is in Laurel map. And the level 4 plus weapon locations, Corlint Island, Grand Travels map, which is the harder Wind Waker map, Corlint Island, Grand Travels map, Laurel map, Grand Travels go Laurel. So it's Corlint, Grand Travels, and Laurel. That's where all the unlocks are for there. 4 plus weapons. I mean, you could technically use grind levels and then just go for the 4 plus weapons right away. Because here's the thing, right? If you, for example, grind up levels on that level square eventually, once I get to find a character, I just need to unlock Twilight Midnight and stuff there, but yeah. But you could basically teleport over to where Yuga was once I figured out that I could use the certain thing, but yeah. And the skull chillers are really, really good, by the way. Because there are more luck levels to certain things, so you can get more certain things to drop. But yeah, the fairy system is actually very, very interesting. So there's fairies in the game now. I believe they were introduced in the Legends one. I don't think they're unique. I don't think there's anything specific unique for the Switch version, aside from the costumes from the Breath of the Wild costume for both Link and Zelda. But yeah, the thing is, like, so there's fairies. The fairies need food. Food is quite hard to drop earlier on, but on certain maps it's easier, and you definitely want to have weapons with the food quote-unquote tag on it, and then use like food potions to increase the chance of certain specific food. Now the thing is, they have a stat thing that increases, and once it increases high enough, you automatically unlock skills and stuff that. But the thing is, they can only reach 799, and then they max out. Now the thing is, however, when you refresh, their stats stay the same, I believe. So that thing that grows won't reset back into tiny thing. So you will, and you will automatically get to like keep all the skills you already have and stuff that, and stuff. And then of course the things that you gain when you level up at level 25 and level 50 respectively. There's things that you gain certain magical special passive skills, and some of them are pretty insane. And the thing is, once you get to level 99, you can refresh. You get to keep all your skills, you get to keep all your stat growth thing or whatever it is, and you also increase the power on the thing, which I'm guessing is what the symbol to the very, very right is, which is currently at 0% power. But each time I believe it increases just by 2%, but I think there are going to be fairies that probably start at a certain percentage level and stuff there, but yeah. But you don't want to basically, you don't want to refresh until you can max out and stuff like that already, so you need to have enough food. So basically you need 99 food to kind of get 99 levels, so yeah. But I think it's of course that now currently I'm just eating whatever food I can get, but often of course I try to use the food on the strongest character for it, but that is not always true, you know, and stuff that's, yeah. Because there are of course rare foods out there that you can only get like one of on certain like rewards on the campaign map. Like you can have them randomly drop as well, but yeah. But of course the stronger foods, you know, increases more stats and stuff there, but yeah. And actually on my first fairy, the light one, I managed to get a double ether. And I have not seen ether be used. I don't know exactly how it works. Because supposedly it's like a magical barrier or something like that. I don't know when it triggers, if it triggers when you activate like the magical meter when it's full. Or if it triggers whenever you do the attack, but you're kind of immune when you're doing the fairy attack anyway, so I don't know what they mean with ether kind of thing, you know, how it works, you know. How does ether work, fairy? Hyrule Warriors Definitive Edition. Oh, well, I can see a meat is feast, milk is drink, mushroom is plant, fish is fish, of course, bomb fish equals weird. There are 39 normal foods in the game, each coming 3 grades. The food is hidden within a brown yard inside an open academic keep, except for Master Wind, okay, man. Normally you can only obtain up to food drops per mission. However, the food cap is increased from 5 to 8, and the mission can drop up to 2 foods under these conditions. Grand Travels map, Corlint Island map with the Coral Triangle active. Fairy skill called Food Master Plus temporarily provides these benefits. Okay. And you start off with 5 fairy slots. There are 9 different adventure mode maps that have a Dark Ruler. Each map you complete by defeating the Dark Ruler will give you an additional fairy slot. So you can have up to 14. Fairies have an 8 character limit for their names. Most fairies have a random name based on another element. There are 3 special fairies in the game that always have a fixed name. Loyola Darkness Fairy with blonde hair on her adventure map. Neris a light fairy on the Corlint Island map. And Becca a water fairy on the Gantos map. I'm pretty certain that I have had Becca, but I could change his name for whatever reason. Fairy stats plus default names. If you attempt to obtain another fairy but already carrying the maximum possible, you'll be asked to release one of your fairies. When you release the fairy, they lose all of the upgrades and return to their unlock mission. So you need to make sure that you don't unlock fairies once you reach the maximum. You have 5 fairy slots. Okay. I mean, you can have a total of 14. First thoughts, okay, so it gives you an additional one. 9 maps, okay, so 9 plus 5, okay, so that's interesting. If you attempt to, okay, blah blah blah. If you release a fairy that is at least level 25, they leave behind a silver grade gratitude crystal. If you release a fairy that is at least level 50, they will leave behind a gold gratitude crystal. The elemental type of the food matches the fairy. So 5 fairy will give you a 5 gratitude crystal. Overworld icons, yellow shirt equals top, green pants equals bottom, mirror with blue handle decoration, red hat is headgear, and purple earrings is accessory. If you capture the appropriate enemy keep, a red and gold treasure chest will spawn in the center, open it to obtain fairy clothing, okay. I already know that. By feeding your fairy food, your fairy will level up at level 25 and level 50. The fairy will earn additional effects for the fairy magic sea dining room. Bombos, fire, lower defense of enemy troops within range. Ether water raises defense for other troops within attack range. So that is when you use the fairy medic. If you have full medic out, you can press down on the right control stick. The thing is, the medic meter doesn't need to be completely full to use it. So you can use it earlier than the normal R move. And stuff that, which is nice. Will cost less medic if the fairy is wearing particular clothing, yeah. This explosion corresponds to the fairy's elemental type. Fairies will deal more damage if their main element matches a recommended elemental stage. So as a bomb boss is fire, lowest defense of enemy troops. Ether raises defense, so I need to remember that. For our troops within attack range, so you buff up your allies. Quake, lightning, lower speed for enemy troops within attack range. Shine, light, restores health for ally troops within attack range. Shade, darkness, inflicts damage on enemy troops within attack range. You can have a combination of fairy magic effects such as Bombus plus Ether, or you can combine two of the same effects such as Bombus for twice the effect power. the radius of the ferromagnetic increase as the ferry leveled up. The radius is very small at level 1 and will be very large at level 99. Yeah, you can hit luck. Like, you can just eliminate some. Dining room. Ferry start off at level 1 and increase to level 99. Bronze food gives you ferry 1 plus level. Silver food gives 2 plus level. Gold food gives 3 plus level. Eat food is associated with the elements. Fire, water, lightning, light and darkness. Matching food element. Okay, so you need to match like the food increase and decreases particular personality traits. If the element of the food matches the main element of the fair, the stat changes will become more beneficial. At level 99, you can continue feeding your fairy, but the personal traits will not increase. Wait, but then you cannot unlock more skills. But the personality traits will not increase. Okay, the traits won't increase, right? But you can still unlock more skills. At that point, because otherwise you always have to refresh to learn more skills. As long as your fairy is not level 50 or higher, you can press the Y button for the change display option. This display possible attributes for the next fairy medic upgrade. Draw two food oddities. Scent seeds boost light despite being favored by darkness fairies. Mystery seeds boost darkness despite being favored by light fairies. At level 25 and level 50, the game will read the elemental attribute that is highest, and that's the size what gives it. Its highest number, and will assign your fairy according fairy magic. For example, if water is the highest number, as you pass over the 25 or the 50, the water attribute ether will be added to fairy magic. So that's why I got double ether. That apparently the food I've been eating has my ought to be water food. Tops, decoration, and accessories will boost the power of my fairy magic attack. Bottoms and headgear reduce the magic cost of a fairy magic attack. Each piece reduce the magic cost by 20%. So if the fairy is wearing a bottom, a headgear, you only need 60% of your magic gauge to be free to use the fairy magic attack. Certain tops will take up both the top and bottom slots. Unfortunately, all tops, whether they take up one or two slots, only offers one damage or boost. Yeah. Only fairy clothing that matches the fairy's element or the fairy magic will have an effect. Otherwise, the clothing effect description will be grayed out. The singing fight doesn't have an effect. Okay. Each fairy can equip up to 4 skills. A fairy starts with 1 skill slot and earns their additional skills at level 10, level 14, level 17. Versa 5, predetermined personality traits, specifically personality traits and stats amounts are needed to obtain a specific skill. Personality traits values range from 0 to 255, sparkly, soft, relaxed, flashy, valiant, DC friendly, dreamy, aspiring, resolute, fleet, shrewd, eager and smiley. And then you have a trust counter. Occasionally, when you are in the dining room of my fairy, your fairy will request to eat a specific food. Bronze, silver food, 0 plus trust, gold food plus 1 trust. Food request, if you get the food wrong, they will be disappointed plus 0 trust. If you get the correct food, they will be moderately happy 2 plus. If you get the exactly correct food, they will be extremely 5 plus off. At every 25 interval of trust, your fairy will give you a gift, such as a weapon or material. Fairies can only give out one gift per feeding, so feed them enough food to pass many 25 interval threshold subscreen. Okay. There's a healing queue, okay. Trust also increases the power of 3 fairy skills, heart bonds, special bonds, and magic bonds. Fairy start off at level 1 and you can reach level 99. When your fairy reaches level 99, the refresh option will appear in the dining room. Press the Y button to refresh your fairy. Upon each refresh, a number of things occur. Optionally change up to one personality trait. Optionally change your fairy's name. The fairy level is reset to level 1. The fairy magic attributes are reset to 0. Fairy magic damage increased by 1% and the refresh count is increased by 1. Personality traits are reset to lower values. Their previous base trait plus 10% or the value before refreshing. So, yeah, so they will always start higher so that you can reach higher. Yeah, there's so much stuff to the system. It is really, 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 really cool though with the multi-fire system. It's really, really quite enjoyable. Like, you can get like extremely busted if you, for example, get the double bomb boss. And stuff like that. But yeah. But the thing is also like, now that I only have like Twilight Midnight left to unlock, you know, it is a bit annoying to reach that square because sometimes the path is not very, very obvious always. And sometimes, you know, you can try to do things to overcomplicate it because sometimes like, oh, there's a ice arrow I can get on this map, and then you get there, or freezing arrow. Now you get there and then you are like, oh, but you need to use this specific character on this square. And then because you can kind of preview a square that's further away that you cannot see yet, but then it doesn't tell you if it's like a specific character. So, yeah. So you can get completely screwed by that if you don't have that character unlocked and stuff like that, but yeah. But yeah, I'm actually planning on making a tier list eventually of the Hyrule Warriors characters and stuff that, you know, eventually once I played enough with them and stuff that, but yeah. Certain characters just kind of seem obvious where to go, but also I do think that certain people are like not very, very good with certain characters. Like, for example, if you played on the Wii U when it was harder, doing like the level 3 weapons and getting the A rank was pretty, pretty rough. Certain characters were of course extremely easy and certain characters were definitely harder, but now it's kind of easier. What I'm guessing on those level 3 maps, they won't have the old statues. So there's the old statues. They were introduced, I believe, in the 3DS version. I'm pretty certain they were not in the default version of the game. Because with the flute, you can teleport around on the maps that have the old statues. And it can allow you to move more effectively and stuff that, and it's just absolutely fantastic, especially to get into locations quick and stuff that. But often the thing is that if you want to make, for example, a map where you have the A rank in order to get a weapon easier, you need to like figure out the optimized path. But of course, a lot is also about the damage. If your damage is not there, then you're gonna struggle. Of course, if you happen to, you know, before you do a level 3 challenge, you kind of want to have a good level 2 weapon. But also, for example, if you have enough levels, then even the lower level weapons will do a lot of damage. So that's very, very important to remember and stuff like that. So yeah. I mean, technically, it's possible to beat all the content in the game with just level 100. That would not have been possible, really, in the Wii U version of the game. I mean, it is kind of possible, but the Wii U version of the game, by the way, the the Twilight Princess map was quite ridiculous. And in that, of course, the last map that was the Majora's Mask map. There wasn't any maps after that, so you never had the Wind Waker map, you never had the Great Sea map, you never had the Koholint Island map, and you never had the Lorule map as well. And Lorule, of course, does not have a Master Quest to it, neither does Koholint and stuff there, so yeah. But yeah. I'm just gonna search if someone has found an answer to that. How is Linkel connected to Link's Awakening? And then Hyrule Warriors Interesting. Yeah, they don't have the things, yeah. Jeg er nå Norma. Jeg kan ikke gå det rett. Det ser väldigt bra ut. Klockan är på nästan European Limited Edition High Wars Legends. Of course, the thing is, she was originally designed as a female version of Link. She was also proposed to be Link's little sister, but the idea was scrapped. Not wanting her to conflict with Aerol, Link's sister in the Wind Waker. At one point in development, a portion of Link's tail featuring Tingle was cut. Oh, yeah. Link would have wandered into the Temple of Souls and found Kira him performing his signature dance in order to could think for unknown reasons, at which points that even Alana would appear to a dance up against Kira. Link would eventually stop the crazy dancing, but discovered that it's not Link who she say but Tingle. And Kel would then be seen waking up, revealing that this was his study demon continue or Kosuke. Yeah, Link has the habit of getting lost. He's in his better directions despite owning a compass and a map. Yeah, but the compass is definitely magical. It's not like the compasses you find in dungeons in the other games. Because it's got the Triforce symbol on it, you know. You know, for all we know, it could actually be like a certain like Triforce piece, or something with the goddess power in it. But then one thing that I think is interesting also, she talks about how her grandma said that she's a hero. So Linkle, of course, the thing that makes more sense to me is that of course she's from an alternate universe. Like, she's not like just female Link, she's own character basically, but the thing here, the amulet that she's wearing, not amulet, but the compass she's wearing, that compass, you know, causes a bunch of things to happen in certain fights, you know, and stuff that, like, it triggers and stuff that, and then like certain, like this, at a certain part you meet a super Dodongo. Like, there is a reskin version of Dodongo that exists that you can normally fight and kill, but this version is like immune to all attacks and you cannot even use the bombs in its mouth, and then eventually the thing triggers and like her, you know, the compass triggers, you know. Minish Cap, Twilight Princess, Beauty, Extra Link Between World, Other Appearances, Hired Warriors. Okay. Yeah, Link has a compass given to her by her grandmother, which has been passed down for generations. The funny thing in the very, very ending, or her ending basically on the very, very last stage, when you finish it, you kind of get a scene with Impa and stuff that how, you know, like you may not be the legendary hero, something, 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 or whatever it is. I forgot exactly what the line was, but it is quite interesting. Like, I think what it's meant to, I don't know if it insinuates it, but I think that Linkle is actually her quote-unquote grandmother that she refers to is actually supposed to be Impa. So she's from an alternate timeline where maybe Link does not exist in that timeline and instead she exists or whatever, and maybe Impa is the person who trained her. Kind of makes sense, right? Because she has that whole hood thing, you know, kind of like sealing her identity at first. You know, and stuff like that. There is like a lot of interesting, like, stuff, you know. And of course, you take care of Kukos as a shepherd. You know, so yeah. It is quite interesting. But yeah, was there something else I was going to cover? Good coffee. Very good coffee. Yeah, very good. So it's gonna be pretty interesting. Like, there's a lot of work in Hyrule Warriors, but yeah. Now, one thing I need to mention about Hyrule Warriors is also the whole fact that I, of course, before I got Hyrule Warriors on the Wii U, I had a lot of things to think about. Oh, will I enjoy this? Because I knew the reputation about Dynasty Warriors game. And the whole reputation is kind of bullshit when you have people who are like, oh, they laugh at that, but then they play X game. And then it's like, okay, but the combat in that game is not great, and you do grinding in that game. Oh, but this grinding is fine, I'm just grinding speedruns. Or whatever, you know, most of that. And then it's just like, Hyrule Warriors is not just made by the team that makes the Dynasty Warriors games. Like, they had a very, very close relationship with Nintendo, so it feels like a Zelda game, but a Mushu game at the same time. And it's not only the fact that, yes, you get materials from enemies, so you can, like, upgrade things and stuff that, there are weapons that you get that can have different, like, stars to them, up to 5 stars. And of course, the weapons exist in different states. The story is pretty, pretty good, and it's actually kind of voiced. There are excellent cutscenes. There's a lot of music from different Zelda games. So, you know, environments-wise, the thing is, the stages aren't kind of from a specific Zelda game, which I'm guessing that could be a smart thing, right? So, the thing is, obviously, when you get to the Wind Waker part of the campaign, which is the final few levels, there's 2 unique stages that are like completely new for the game, which is pretty interesting. Although I haven't seen those stages, sadly, on an Adventure map, but I'm adding right. Like, there's, of course, certain stages in the game that's obviously from, like, Twilight Princess, like, 2 stages, I believe, are specific Twilight Princess. There's, of course, Skyward Sword stage, 2 of them, I believe. I'm trying to think what else, because Skyward Sword definitely has stages in the game. Twilight Princess has stages in the game. But then, for example, like, you don't have, like, quote-unquote Ocarina of Time stages that feels like, okay, these are definitely the Ocarina of Time stage. Or like, oh, this is the Majora's Mask stage. Or this is like a low rule stage and stuff that, like you know, like, I definitely think because of Hyrule Warriors selling well, and I don't know how Age of Calamity sells, which I'm gonna get eventually. There's like a lot of Switch games I plan to get this year and stuff that, you know, and I'm gonna get them over time, you know, and stuff that. And there's also DLC that I'm gonna be getting for other games, like Pokemon Sword Shield still needs to get that DLC pass, because it's basically 2 expansions. And I need to get the DLC for the Cadence of Hyrule and stuff that. So yeah, so there's a lot of interesting things. And the Calamity is, of course, another MOSI, which is like High Warriors, but it's Breath of the Wild themed. So I'm guessing all of the characters are Breath of the Wild characters in that. So yeah. But then of course, imagine right, if they would do more focused games, you know, and stuff that like oh, they had an adventure mode map, but they only had like one or whatever, you know, or however they do it. But imagine right, because, you know, yes, there are like Twilight Princess maps, but there aren't that many. But imagine right, if they have like, oh, this game focuses on Ocarina of Time, or maybe you would have a game that focuses on both Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask, instead of just focusing on one, so you can have like more characters. Now you could have a game that focuses on Twilight Princess specifically, because Twilight Princess is large enough to have a lot of characters, I think, from specifically Twilight Princess. But then also you could have one game focusing on Wind Waker, Phantom Hourglass, and Spirit Tracks. And then you would have stages from all of those in it, and stuff like that, yeah. That would be pretty interesting. Now, the question is, though, is there always something like similar to the adventure mode in like the music games and stuff there? Because I'm guessing, right, because otherwise if you would just have like story mode, I feel like there wouldn't be enough gameplay into just like story mode and stuff like that, which is why adventure mode maps are important, you know, to unlock stuff, you know, but yeah. I'm actually gonna look up, you know, so I will Horus Age of Calamity. Characters. Because how many characters are there? Man can also use Link, Impa and Zelda. The champions, Daruk, Mipha, Rivali, and Urbosa. Other characters, Hestu, Monkmas, Koshia, and Great Fairies. And then you have late game characters, Ryu, Air and Lightning, Sidon, Water and Fire, Teba, Air and Lightning, Yanubo, Water and Fire, Zelda, Bow, Light Version, Master Koga, King Roham. Wow. You can take control of the King of Hyrule at the end of this mission. That's interesting, so they have like double like element characters and stuff that. Yeah, Link in almost every story mission, and like other characters, Link can use multiple weapons. I'm gonna check if there is an adventure mode in this or not. Not everything is on the main map. The main game basically is adventure mode combined with story mode, so yeah, so they have actually combined it. Yeah, because this is like the Age of Calamity is more focused on like a single character, not like having to rely on like allies or, you know, like. Can we get a full picture of that? Oh, let's check the Amiibo support here for it. All amiibos, including non-Zelda team amiibo, can be used to claim rewards in the game. Each amiibo can only be scanned once, and a total of 5 amiibos can be scanned once per day. Okay, so it's like the other thing. You can receive random weapons or materials from scanning amiibos. If you close the game after scanning and before playing, and then the date you were playing changes, you receive a prompt to remind you that the reward has not yet been collected from previous scan, so he has to keep all the rewards received. And farm for rupees, fuse weapons. Okay, so the map is basically like the. A map for the 4 champions. London Ranch. Jag bäst säker på att det är London Ranch som ligger som Ocarina of Time. Mamba Village, Scarecrows. Horse Guard, ja. Damn, you can have a lot of hearts in that. Om secret ending. Hyrule Warriors outfit. You can unlock the Hyrule Warriors outfit as a reward for completing game 100%. And so the first Hyrule Warriors game will remember this outfit. Costumes, unlockables, okay. Oh, there's a lot of costumes. Cooking recipes, treasure chests. Yeah, man, it definitely looks like it's like Breath of the Wild and stuff like that, but. Oh, right, and the maps are basically sections from like places in like Breath of the Wild. So damn, it looks so cool, man. It looks really, really, really cool. Two-play mode, okay. Two-play modes are still in from the start, okay. The devoted Kodashi, a short sword. That's for Impa specific, okay. So I wonder if they would have stat boosts certain other gears like they do actually Oh, so it's an alternate timeline 100 years before the events of Breath of the Wild. Alright, so between like the main story modes, there are like side missions, and then you're basically going out on the complete, like, on the full version of basically the entire Breath of the Wild map, and they unlock like more side quests of time, and then you can decide to, oh, I'm gonna do this side quest, boonk. Okay, so things appear on the map, and it can be one of three things: side missions, shops, or power-ups. Side missions are same as main missions, and you get placed on the map with a bunch of enemies, but compared to the main story, the objective is different. Yeah, like escort a different character from one point to another, kill a certain amount of enemies without getting hit. So they're kind of like the adventure mode things, but they're actually side missions this time around, the adventure mode stuff. It's shops. You can buy resources, level up your characters, and upgrade your weapons. So you need the shop to actually level up the character. Power-ups. And then you use resources to get like more health, more combos, more special meter. So that kind of works like the thing, like the bazaar thing in Hyrule Warriors, like where you basically can be like, oh, I want to unlock more attacks and stuff that, or I have the materials for it. So yeah, that's kind of the same. But the fact that you need to do it between missions, that apparently you cannot do it while on a mission. I mean, yeah, you do it between missions. That's kind of what you do in Hyrule Warriors as well. But they make it sound like, oh, you have to find a shop. Oh, you didn't get a shop this time. Oh, well, you know, we cannot upgrade your character. No, it's just between missions. Like, you can do that. And of course, you can also get the powers from Breath of the Wild and stuff that, yeah. Musou or Dynasty Warriors clone. Yeah, the frame rate can dip very, very low. But that's not too weird, really, and usually it's not that much of a problem, you know. It's only specific situations where it occurs in, and you can kind of prevent it from happening also if you do certain things, kind of, you know. But yeah. Because, oops, it was empty. Water bottle. First burp, you know, in the bathroom. Boink. Get some more toilet paper. But yeah, so, was there something else? Yes, I mean, I've written down some of the other games, so like Age of Calamity I'm planning on eventually getting the Pokemon Brilliant Diamond, which of course Pokemon Diamond was my first Pokemon game that I owned. It was not the first one that I played, but yeah, Pokemon Diamond was my first one, and I got the Gold after that, and then I believe I got one on the DS or the 3DS, although I'm not 100% certain. But then after that I got Pokemon Sword and Shield, or Shield specifically, and stuff like that, so yeah. And you know, Pokemon Arceus and stuff that I haven't played super much of Arceus yet, only 1 hour or whatever, but yeah. It's just Hyrule Warriors, it's so addicting, you know, and stuff that, and that's the thing, like, Hyrule Warriors is just great if you want something to, like, to grind on, you know, and you know that, oh, I can advance towards this and stuff that, you know, like, it's just very, you know. And then, like, in the adventure mode map, like, things are way quicker than, like, main story stuff, you know, especially if you want to do everything, you know, and stuff like that, but yeah. I think that's probably going to do it for this time. I am planning to get a... I wonder if they have webcam section on it. I've never checked if they have webcams or not on here. Because I should definitely probably add one to like favorite and stuff that just to see if there are like... Okay, so... So, web camera. Okay. Can I have like a 4K filter? Is there a 4K? There are like live stream cameras. So, how many brands are there? Oh, Razer has some. What does that Razer ones look like? Okay, the Razer one actually looks pretty good. But I'm actually a fan of the Logitech thing. So that's 1080, 720, 1080, Ultra HD 4K. 15 megapixel on that one. C920 Pro. The one I have is... What is it? C920, okay. Yeah, wait, so mine is 15 megapixel then. Yeah. No. It doesn't have that Logitech branding. I'm guessing it's a newer model of it. Because it's called HD Pro now. Because that's not the way mine looks. Mine is a much, much older model then. It's definitely worth getting like a 4K Logitech Brio 4K Steam Edition webcam. Ultra HD 4K with HDR. Four K Ultra HD with 30 or 24 FPS 2K. Yeah, VQHD is 2K. That's 2560x1440. So it is a 2K resolution. It's just that TVs are just bullshitting and on YouTube they're not they're just calling it an HD resolution. They're not calling it the WQHD, which is true what it is like. Except the W. So is that wide? Wide quality or something, wide quality HD or something like that. Because 2K is basically double the resolution of 1080p, and then the fact that they're just calling it HD is stupid. Okay, so it's only 13 megapixel on that one. But there is of course the 4K. Det är Stream Deck, Elgato Stream Deck. Do you have that on that? Do you really have to have a stream in order to make Stream Decks work? Because I'm pretty certain, right, that you can have a Stream Deck and you can just have like functions that are useful like when you're like YouTubing and stuff that, or just well, like when you're gaming in general, because you can I believe you can like pro, yeah, 32 programmable LCD buttons, and I believe you can use those in gaming as well. Oh, it's compatible with YouTube as well. Yeah, because you could have like a... You could have like an audio thing. So you could run an intro with that. But doesn't that work like when you're like if I would be recording this, for example, and I program Scream Deck to run on intro, would that automatically run on intro then over the thing I'm recording? And stuff like that. That's pretty interesting actually. As a conference kit that basically contains like a high-end like web camera, it contains like one of those like audio things that's for like for conference meetings, that's like super expensive. Omnisound with HD sound camera with 4K 123 degrees, so you can basically record like all around you and stuff that like it's like insanely weird. Yeah, Canada is expensive. Conference camera, which has like 360 angles, and then we got one of the 4Ks there. There aren't that many that has actually 4K. That is a bit odd. So yeah, there's just one, or which is just a web camera. And stuff that those web cameras look so weird, but you just place them out and then you have 360, so you can have like a, so you can basically sit all around the room and then it basically records like absolutely everything, and you just plug it in, plug and play. Is it 4K though? Like what is the rest on it? Yeah, maximum is only 1920x1080. It has the high end though, it has the H264, which is the one that you use, that one takes up less space than older formats. But the fact that that isn't 4K then. So those are really expensive. And there you have conference kit. Yeah, these are camera with 4K. So you could get a cheaper one for Confdel C20 Ego. You could get that for not super much. Camera with 4K Ultra HD. Okay, so that's 3840x2160. So that's 2160p, which is only 3K resolution, by the way. That's not the real 4K resolution. Because obviously it's the next step up from my resolution. So it doesn't go from 2K to 4K. So this is the 3K resolution that they are saying is a full 4K resolution on TVs. 3840x2160 is not 2 4K resolution, it's 3K. But I don't call it that because of bullshit reasons. Because remember how they said, oh, this is 1920x1080, this is full HD, but then it wasn't. And then they made a big thing out of, oh, this is true full HD and stuff like that, but yeah. So that also has super speed USB 3.0. So it's a telephone speaker and a camera nav. So it has a microphone built in. And it's a package for up to 6 members, 123 degrees picture angle, Omnisound. So you could use speak. I'm guessing, and it picks up all the voices. But how does the web camera work? Because that web camera you don't even need to put on a computer screen. So it goes virtual panorama, it goes tilting, it goes zooming, it goes out focus. 4K 30. Oh man, if I would get one of those. Yeah, the video kit is so fucking cool. And like that thing in the middle is the one that records the audio. Then you had a webcam, of course, and then you have some kind of kit there. I'm guessing it's to a hub that has its own like power source that you plug in and stuff like that, but that's really, really cool. Although it's just, you know, that's great if you're gonna have a lot of people, but if you're just gonna do yourself, then it's just better to get the regular 4K camera and stuff like that. But otherwise, yeah, the most expensive one there is like up to 12 people. Oh, so I'm guessing it, you can split up it. You can split up the picture then, I think. That's what I mean with this 123-degree angle. So if you get, for example, the most expensive one, then you can have like 12 people. So you can split it up. Yeah, that's interesting. Oh, do they have it in stock? Yes, they do. I'm gonna add this to favorites. Kollo Terrorita. And we do the Harlem Shake. Because, yeah, sure, this is expensive, but the fact that I could get the 4K camera is gonna improve the quality a lot, you know, and, you know, it's gonna be great with the 4K camera and stuff like that, you know, so, yeah. You know, because I've been wanting to get one for a long time, and I mean, this is like really, really good quality, this video camera and stuff that, you know, and stuff that, like, I've had this for such a long time, you know, and I prefer it over my other video camera, which technically that video camera has higher like megapixels than this one, but it's like, it's just, you know, nice and stuff that, but yeah. So, and that's gonna do it for this time. I'll see whenever I do the next video and stuff that, yeah. I will, of course, be doing more screenshots in High Wars and stuff that, you know. You know, the grind spot is kind of still the best grind spot, although there are grind spots on other maps that you can kind of say is good, but it depends on what level you are, of course, obviously, you know. Certain grind spots are way better at like lower levels, but the thing is also, like, once your fire becomes high enough, the grind spot that is on the lower left of the map becomes even more effective, because the higher level your fire gets, the more she can kill at once on the map. And the thing is, if you kill the bosses quick enough, for example, once one character is high enough level, then you're just gonna get way more kills. Like, the highest I've gotten is over like something like 4,000 kills on a single mission. I don't know if there is a cap, like of 9,099 kills or whatever, but yeah. But I think it's just that you can gain a lot of levels, like really, really quickly and stuff that. With that, of course, you want to be using XP on the weapons and stuff that, and also XP accelerator and stuff that, so yeah. Although I kind of wish that there would exist plus version of skills, or like higher versions of certain skills and stuff that, like higher recipes or whatever, you know, or higher. Like, for example, on the plus weapons, on like Medical Sword Plus and on the Double Elemental weapons, on those there should exist like Super XP Plus or whatever. Or, you know, like a stronger version of the XP Plus. So there would be basically be like stronger version of Rupee Plus, stronger version of XP Plus, stronger version of slots and stuff like that. And maybe there will be plus plus or two plus. Or whatever, you know, or call it just super XP plus, you know, stuff that, you know, or, you know, like whatever, or master XP plus, you know, and stuff that, you know, because yeah, they can do a lot of stuff, but yeah, yeah, I will see you probably, I don't know what date, actually interesting thing is tomorrow, of course. In Hearthstone, they released a new expansion. Except, of course, here in Europe, we're probably going to have to wait until Wednesday. But sometimes that's not true. Sometimes we could receive it earlier and stuff like that, but yeah. Because the new Hearthstone mini set is going to be out. And the thing is, of course, good that I haven't done I haven't finished the quest yet for more packs. I have two legendary quests at the same time. Hopefully they don't disappear or whatever, you know, and gets replaced or whatever, but yeah. Because the thing is, if I finish them when the miniset is out, there is a very, very high chance that I'm going to get some of the miniset cards and stuff like that. And that's going to be fantastic. You know, and stuff like that. Because there are certain cards in the miniset that is really powerful, because it's very, very dragon-focused and, you know, There's also like the Kasaka thing is like, then dragons can be your only minions, if I remember correctly. Now, technically, I don't know if there is enough dragons to where all decks could be like a dragon focus deck, because the main problem would be, of course, that a lot of dragons are not used like common and stuff, that there needs to exist enough common dragons and stuff that, because if you have to rely on a bunch of like epic or legendary dragons, then it's gonna be harder. Of course, you do have a lot of dragons though via... The main problem is, of course, that you cannot run a dragon deck with the Kazaku-san. You cannot run with a dragon deck with that and then make Vandar work, because Vandar is not a dragon. But yeah, but otherwise, there's probably going to be big dragon decks, most likely, and then that uses Vandar, because Vandar is, of course, like, oh, if everything else is more expensive than Vandar, then reduce their cost by, what is it, 2 or 3? Whatever. And that could be, like, pretty pretty insane, because, like, 5 cost becomes, like, what, like, 3, 2, 1? 1 cost? 5 cost become 1 cost? Or is Vandar 5 cost? I forgot if one was 5 cost. Yeah, I think Vandar is 5 cost, so... So 6 cost become, basically, like, 2 cost. 7 cost becomes 3 cost. 8 cost becomes, you know, etc, etc. And, you know, like, if you pull Vandar early, then that could be, like, insanely powerful and stuff that, but yeah. I think it's just, though, that with dragons, of course, you can have, like, a power spike of, like, really, really powerful, like, end stuff, you know, and stuff that, so, yeah, it's gonna be quite interesting. Let me actually go in here and double check on the site, just how it's gonna end, you know, and stuff that, but yeah. So yeah, cards sorted by class. You have Demon Hunter's cards here first. So that's Demon Hunter, that's Druid, that's Hunter, that's Mage, that's Paladin. Paladin doesn't really get any dragon here. On the class-specific cards, they do get a Stormborn Avenger, a Battle Vicar, and a Ring of Courage. Battle Vicar is pretty insane. Just give it a Holy Spell. That is better than draw a Holy Spell, because you can discover specific ones that you don't have in your deck. Stormborn Avenger is pretty busted, I think. Because I think what you're meant to do is use Ring of Courage with Stormborn Avenger. If you cast a spell on this minion, it gains 2 plus attack. That's also going to be insanely wild, because then you can use the Librams with it and stuff that. And yeah. And then, of course, if you run Lady Liadrin, you can just copy all the buff that you have kind of cast, so yeah. And then the neutral cards, of course. There aren't that many neutrals. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 neutrals. So there's Onyxian Warder, Gear Grubber, Whelp Bonker, Rayboss Onyxian, Caster Khan. Onyxian Warder is the only new luck dragon that is black common. And then you have 2 legendary dragons. Warrior gets a dragon. Warlock gets a dragon. Rogue does not get a dragon. Priest gets a dragon and a dragon spell that summon dragons. Warrior, I need to mention. Just double checking here. Yeah, Paladin gets no dragon, sadly. A mage not only gets a dragon, they get a dragon, just get the Dragonfire Amulet, which discovers 2 dragons, summon them. And yeah, that's pretty, pretty busted. Hunter gets no dragon, except to get Counter Dragon synergy. I think they should have made it somehow, so it should have done more damage to dragons. So Dragonbane Shot deals 2 damage on the blue kill, adds Dragonbane Shot to your hand. You know. I mean, Dragonbane Shot, there should have been like an effect if it hits a dragon. If it hits a dragon, deal exactly lethal damage. So that if you hit a dragon, you deal its health in damage. So you always trigger the honorable kill if you're hunting dragons. But then I would have turned Dragonbane Shot into a legendary spell if you're actually up against dragons, because yeah, if you're up against dragons, then Dragonbane Shot, in my opinion, should just deal whatever health the dragon has. So dragon has 12 health, boom, 12 damage. I didn't get any right. So yeah. Scale of Onyxia, of course, druids get them, so they don't get a dragon card specifically, but they can summon a bunch of whelps, and all those counts as dragons, and stuff that. And Demon Hunter gets no dragons, so yes. Let's search for Vandor. Wait, is it Van? Yeah, not three N's. Vanenen. Yeah, it's four. If this cost less than every minion in your deck, reduce the cost by three. So it is four cost for him. So five, four, three, two. So five costs are two. Six cost are three. Seven cost are four. Eight cost is five. Nine cost is six. And 10 cost is seven. So yeah. If this costs less than every minion, they can reduce the cost by three. Of course, if there were a specific way to tutor, like draw, like specifically a four-cost card, then this could be insane. Of course, technically in Wild, you can run the Paladin, is it called to Adventure? I'm pretty certain it's called to Adventure, right? Yeah, draw the lowest cost minion from your deck, give it +2/+2. So you could tutor Vandor with that in Wild, Call to Adventure. You only technically need to run one Call to Adventure, but it's better to run two so you have a higher chance of drawing it. And since Vandor is going to be the lowest, Vandor is going to be the lowest because everything else must be higher than Vandor. So Vandor would always be the lowest. So boom, Call to Adventure right there, boom. So I wonder if there is anything about like running Vandor and Call to Adventure. Like, has anyone mentioned? Nope. Damn, there's no like new answers on that. Yeah, only from 2019. Yeah. Call to. I mean, it's probably not really that good even, like, you know. I got to Adventure, which was in Rise of Shadows. And stuff there, but yeah. So yeah. But yeah. This time I'm gonna end, I swear. So yeah. But yeah. 4K camera, don't know when I'm gonna be getting it, but yeah, I mean, I need to prioritize the Swift games and stuff like that. Now the thing though, just one final thing, Mario Kart, of course, I have had it on the Wii U, I had all the DLC for it, I did play it a lot, and unlocked everything pretty much, except for one thing, I think. The thing, however, is that the Switch version I haven't gotten yet, I will probably be getting it, however, here's the thing, right? So, there's going to be new tracks. The main problem I have is that these new tracks, right, they're coming in packages and there's going to be 48 tracks total and they're going to start in March with the first pack. Now, the question is how often are they going to be, because I believe there's 5 packs total. Is it? So, it's Calculor. So, it's 48 tracks divided by... No, that would have to be 12 packs then. So 48 divided by 4. Yeah, they're not doing 12 packs. I forgot how many maps is it in each one. because it's, wait, so it's now restarted. Ah, damn it. I think, no, that cannot be corrected. It cannot be 5, because that would be 9.6. So 48 divided by, is it 6? Eight packs, is that correct then? 8 packs. Because I thought I saw in each pack that there was way less than that. Boost the course. Contain 48 tracks. The track will be released in 6 waves. Okay, so 48 divided by 6. That was 8. So that must mean that it must be 8, right? Yeah, there must be 8 tracks in each single one. The first wave of circuits will arrive on March 18, 2022. Subsequent waves will take place all the way up to the end of 2023. Yeah, the DLC will cost blah blah blah. But there's just a one-off cost, and that gives you all of it. Oh, wave 1, Golden Dash and Lucky Cat Cups. Yes, so they are cups. That is great. Golden Dash Cup is wave 1. That is Paris Promenade from Mario Kart, the Death Tour, that, like the iPhone game. Toad Circus from 3DS, Choco Mountain and Nintendo 64, Coconut Muffin from Wii. Tokyo Blur, Lucky Cat Cup, Tokyo Blur from the Tour, Shroom Ridge from 3DS, Sky Garden from Game Advance, and Ninja Hideaway from Thor. Yes, there will be cups. This was something I was worried about, that they weren't gonna do the cups, but it's 1, 2, 3, 4. But it's 4 stages and it's cup. Right, but they'll do 2 cups at once. So wave 1, so there will always be 8 tracks. Right, so that's why they can do 6. So there's 2 cups each time. So there's 8 each time and there's gonna be 6. So that means that it's gonna be like... So it's 6 times 2 then. So there's gonna be 12 cups total added. 12 cups total, because there's 4 stages in this one, and that's the 8th one, you know, and it's 8 times, you know. 8 times 6, that's 48 tracks, so... So there's gonna be 12 more cups! 12 more cups... 12 more cups! Tracks will be released in 6 waves. March, April, May, June, July, August, September, October, November, December. So that's 9 months. In 6 waves. So I took 9, because there will be 9 months left, not counting March then, so that would be 10, if it would count as March. So 10 divided by 2, that would be 5. So if it's released every 2 months, then there's not going to be 6 waves. So there's basically gonna be only like 1 month in between most of these. Yeah, that's insane. Oh, that's just insane, man. Yeah, the sound is actually turned off now here on the microphone and stuff there, but yeah. I hope this won't mess up the sound of the But yeah, but that seems pretty insane. Like, if they released in March, then basically, like, if they would release over 2 months, then there wouldn't be enough months left of the month. There's only like 9 months left and stuff like that, so that doesn't work. So then it would almost have to be released every month. But maybe there would be a longer delay at first, but then they would basically spread it out. Like, maybe there would be a break during the summer and then just bam, 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 bam. Or whatever, I don't know. Because I really don't hope that it really just be like, you know, maybe they should make it just sort of the next 3 months. Like, March, April, May are gonna be months with one pack each. So then it's 3 pack. And then there's the summer vacation, June, July, August, and then September, October, November. So then the final thing comes in November instead of December. Yeah, that's most likely what they would do. Probably. So yeah. Anyway, hope you have enjoyed this and happy Valentine's Day, everyone. And yeah, so hope you all enjoyed this video, and I will see you next time.